Good evening and welcome back to Jake's Takes. We're on episode 23 in a blessed Advent season to you all. I'm John Jacobson, state representative from Iowa's 22nd District, which encompasses the lion's share of Pottawatomie County, bordering with our great Nebraska neighbors from Douglas and Sarpy County, including our great guest tonight, back by popular demand, the Reverend Michael Gutzel, JCL, canon lawyer, pastor in Sarpy County of the Southern Cross for the Archdiocese of Omaha, St. Joseph's Catholic Church in Springfield, Nebraska, a suburb of Omaha on the south side, of course. Father, in addition to being pastor, has served the Archdiocese over the years as moderator of the Curia and Chancellor of the Archdiocese of Omaha, as well as the longest tenured in modern history pastor and rector of St. Cecilia Cathedral, as well as superintendent of their National Blue Ribbon School. Welcome back, Father Gutzel.
Welcome, John.
Father, it's so great to have you back with us this evening. We got such tremendous response last year during this season with you opening up for us the O Antiphons. We'd like to take that further this year, remind some of those that saw last year but with new audience members to take that course because the timing is perfect, almost to the day. So take it away, Father Gutzel. Delighted to have you again with us this evening.
Great. Well, an antiphon, of course, is a brief sentence typically that precedes and then follows in the liturgy of the hours, or the way in which sacred prayer sanctifies time through the course of each day. And the antiphon kind of sets a tone or a theme for the reflection upon the significant canticle. And so this would apply now to the Vesper canticle called the Magnificat. These are words taken directly from St. Luke's Gospel, the words of Mary as she is visiting her cousin Elizabeth. Both have been, are now pregnant, and Elizabeth, through the message of an angel to her husband Zechariah, the priest in the temple, who did not accept or didn't believe the message of the angel Gabriel, and so she has become pregnant with John the Baptist. And some short time after that, the same angel, Gabriel, appeared to a virgin of Judean side and addressed her as full of grace and identified her as the one who would bear a son who would be known wholly as the Son of God. This this canticle is a number of verses. When it is prayed in group, there's an alteration that goes on between these verses from one side to another. It's one of the favorite canticles that's found in the New Testament. A canticle is like a psalm, which is the contents of the book of Psalms, the prayer book of the Bible. And so for the days now, from the 17th until the 23rd, there are seven unique antiphons. And these are taken from the prophet Isaiah, and they identify the specific titles for the anticipated and expectant Messiah, the anointed one of God. And so this goes back into monastic times. And of course, they would have done this in Latin. However, for the majority of people, they already know these titles that are contained in what is often thought to be a Christmas carol called O Come Emmanuel. So if you've ever sung that that hymn, you would have sung all 7 of these antiphons, because they constitute this particular Advent hymn as opposed to a Christmas hymn. So the interesting thing about that Advent hymn is that it cheats. It starts with the final of the titles. That's the name for it, O Come Emmanuel. And then it goes to the first in the lineup, all the way through the sixth. So that would be 7. You take the last one, make that the first. And so the second becomes the first of the line. And then they repeat O Come Emmanuel. So they use O Come Emmanuel twice. Hope that is understandable. And this was constructed with a mnemonic sort of construction, so that there would be the message of each of these antiphons, highlighted, of course, by the opening word or two, which is the key name for the Messiah. So if that is that's following at this point. So the first of the titles is O Wisdom, O Sapientia is the Latin. O Wisdom, Holy Word of God, you govern all creation with your strong yet tender care. It is a reflection now on the way in which God embraces not only the time in which his fullness will deliver the Messiah, but it's also in the anticipation, because Isaiah, of course, is about 700-800 years before Jesus. So the longest Advent that ever was experienced is what we call the Old Testament. So O Wisdom is so necessary for not only one's patience, but the expectation that will come. And so Isaiah 11 is a key to this particular opening antiphon. So the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, a spirit of wisdom and understanding, a spirit of counsel and of strength, a spirit of knowledge and of fear of the Lord, and his delight shall be the fear of the Lord. So this opening, which will be used tomorrow, tomorrow evening, will be the first of these 7 antiphons. The second is one of the principal names used for God in the Old Testament. In the ancient times, it was prohibited under pain of death to pronounce the name of God. And so there were various kind of circumlocutions that were used in place of the word Yahweh. And one of those was Adonai. We use this today quite frequently. We say the Lord. And of course, when we do that in prayer, or as we make reference, O Lord, bless us, O Lord, and so forth, it's pretty well known who we are addressing. So, O Adonai, O sacred Lord of ancient Israel, who showed yourself to Moses in the burning bush, who gave him the holy law on Sinai's mountain, come, stretch your mighty hand to set us free. So this reaches back to that encounter that Moses, who was in the desert, he was in the witness protection program since he had fled Egypt, having killed a soldier who was roughing up one of his Hebrew relatives. And so he's out, you know, watching the sheep, and he sees this bush that's burning but not consumed. And so he goes over, and the bush starts talking, "Take off your sandals, for you are standing on sacred ground." And so the Lord directs Moses to go back to the very place he's hiding out from to address the Pharaoh to release his people. It is this word, "Who shall I say sent me? I am who am," is the answer given in the scripture. "O Adonai, O sacred Lord of ancient Israel." Once again, Isaiah 11 is called upon, and we are addressed. Yes, the Lord our judge, the Lord our lawgiver. So Moses is understood in the long history of humankind as one who delivers the law of God. And of course, we call that the commandments. Even our own Supreme Court has the declaration of Moses as a lawgiver. Then the third is, "O Radax Jesse," O flower or root of Jesse. Who is Jesse? Well, Jesse was the father of David. And so this antiphon, "O flower of Jesse's stem, you have been raised up as a sign for all peoples. Kings stand silent in your presence. The nations bow down in worship before you." So once again, this prophecy that was delivered through the fourth son of Jacob, Judah, and out of that line would come the anointed one called King David. And this this special kind of, if you will, reversal, where the people of Israel had proven unfaithful and they were literally cut off, both the northern tribes and the southern tribes, and carried away into exile. And there seemed to be no future left, but out of the stump of Jesse's line would come this flower, this Radax Jesse, and from that, of course, would be David. And so it says, "Remember also Jesse was the father of David. Micah had prophesied that the Messiah would be of the house and lineage of David, born in David's city, Bethlehem." That from Micah the prophet is how the wise men who are told or spoken of in Matthew's gospel, they followed a star, but they could only get to Jerusalem, and they had no further way of finding where the newborn king of Israel would be found. And so they show up thinking that King Herod will be full of joy to know that they have been following this star, but they needed help. And so Herod, who of course didn't know very much at that point, turned to his scribes and priests and says, "Where is this to happen?" And they said, "Well, of course, it's in Micah. He's going to be in Bethlehem," which was not very far from Jerusalem. And lo and behold, only the foreigners who had traveled, as far as we can tell, at least 2 years, find the Lord and deliver their precious gifts to him. So we've got, "O Sapientia," O wisdom, "O holy word of God," O Adonai, the sacred Lord of ancient Israel, O Radax Jesse, the flower of Jesse's stem. So the fourth one is, O Clavis David, O key of David. In the ancient world, a key was a symbol of power as well as responsibility. We have so many different ways nowadays that oftentimes a metal device that's shaped, you know, to fit into a lock has been replaced by so many things that are now digitized, computerized, numbers, all sorts of ways in which we commit to memory how to get into something, how to get out of something. It's still a potent sign and symbol of things. O key of David, O royal power of Israel, controlling at your will the gate of heaven. We only speak of the gate of heaven in kind of a metaphorical sort of way, but we know that the access to relationship with God is one that is not simply the result of whipping out a password or a metal little device that we stick into a lock. There is something far more significant that is at issue. And so this from Isaiah 22, I will place the key of the house of David on his shoulder. When he opens, no one will shut. When he shuts, no one will open. This dramatic prophecy, not just a foretelling of the future, but prophecy of this access to God is made possible not by a device and not by a password, but by the very presence of God himself. And then, Orions, as we say, the Orient or the orientation, which is basically a word that means to face east. So the rising sun is a significant symbol in Judaism and in Christianity as the expectation of the glory of the Lord coming, both in his first arrival, which the Jewish people are still looking for, or for Christians, for his coming in glory and the conclusion of all things that have passed. And so, O radiant dawn, splendor of eternal light, Son of justice, come, shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death. There's an interesting thing there in this Isaiah 9 reference, those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death. When the 12 tribes of Jacob came and were divided across the land of Israel, the promised land, there's a whole kind of study of this division of things. The most northern divisions were taken up by two tribes, and these two tribes, while they were certainly legitimate offspring of Jacob, their most northern kind of location put them into contact with pagan peoples and the kind of traveling trade routes and the movement of armies from the north into the south, from across, you know, where we now have Iraq and Iran, down into Egypt and vice versa. It was a very busy sort of place, and they were exposed to the to these temptations and so forth. And so the very first place that the Lord appeared was in these two places that became called Galilee. So his presence, and for 30 years, we are told in the gospel, he was present there. We don't know what he did. We don't know how he moved across this whole area, but his light was like the radiant dawn, casting away the darkness that was so much a part of Israel's history. And then, O Rex Gentium, O King of the nations. O King of the nations, the only joy of every human heart, O keystone of the mighty arch of man, come and save the creature you fashioned from the dust. And so this is drawing upon Isaiah 9, where there is this kind of litany of names that is also part of the wonderful oratorio called the Messiah, Wonder Counselor, God Hero, Father Forever, Prince of Peace. Those are all names that appear in Isaiah 9 and the 5th chapter. This kind of flourish of ways in which the King of the Nations is further named and attribution of his saving power and presence is there. And so Isaiah, of course, the one who has so many flourishes about the coming of the Messiah, he delivers this in his second chapter, Isaiah second chapter, verse 4. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. One nation shall not raise sword against another, nor shall they train for war again. How many times has that verse been quoted over history, not by preachers and priests, but by statesmen calling for peace, calling for the abandonment of weapons of destruction that are turned into the tools of harvest and the tools that would bring forth the richness that could be shared in a peaceful way. And so we see in this progression, O Sapientia, O Wisdom of God, O Adonai, O Sacred Lord of Ancient Israel, O Radex Jesse, O Flower of Jesse's Stem, O Clavis David, the Key of David, the Royal Power of Israel, O Oriens, O Radiant Dawn, Splendor of Eternal Light, O Rex Gentium, King of all the nations, the only joy of every human heart, comes then to the final of the antiphons, O Emmanuel. This word, Emmanuel, in the New Testament shows up only in one place, and that's the Gospel of Matthew. It is given in the dream to Joseph that he will name the child to be born of Mary. First is Jesus, God saves. That's what the meaning of the word Jesus means. And then there is added the second name, and he shall be called Emmanuel. What does Emmanuel mean? God is with us. God is with us. This is used in Isaiah. And if I'm not mistaken, it appears in one other place. Not so sure I can call that at the present moment. It is in Isaiah 7, 14, in Isaiah for sure. O Emmanuel, King and Lawgiver, Desire of the Nations, Savior of all people, come and set us free. So it kind of gathers together a number of the preceding antiphons, and then it results in the Lord himself will give you this sign, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel. So the only other place this shows up in the gospel, besides the angel speaking to Joseph in a dream at the very beginning, is at the end of Matthew's gospel, when Mary Magdalene is told, go tell my brothers to meet me in Galilee, that land of darkness and the shadow of death, where Jesus first was present and became public and called his disciples from that very area to proclaim the gospel. And so when they come and find him there, we are told they bowed down and worshiped. There's a couple of different places in Matthew where this solemn sort of action takes place. When the kings find Jesus following Micah, they bow down and do him homage before they open their gifts. He was not their God, But they come because they have interpreted the signs of the sky as having an import that is larger than anybody recognizes. And then, of course, in one particular place, when Jesus cures the 10 lepers, the one who comes back bows down and gives him thanks. He was a Samaritan. So this is a rich, rich kind of action and posture that is caught up now. And so Jesus says to them, go out into the world and proclaim the gospel, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And here it comes. Know that I am with you until the end of the age. So Jesus doesn't use the name Emmanuel. He speaks who he is. Emmanuel, I am with you until the end of the age. And so running from the 17th through the 23rd, and that allows us to go into the Christmas vigil and then into Christmas Day. So these seven antiphons, these special little sentences that are drawn all from Isaiah and build the dramatic kind of anticipation that concludes Advent has been in the worship of the church for centuries. So when the clever monks who put this together, what they did was they then took the first letter of each of these antiphons. So Emmanuel, the E, the Rex for King, R, Oriens, the radiant dawn, O, Clavis, the key, Radex, the root, the stem, Adonai, the O Lord, and then Sapientia, wisdom. And that created a word, actually created two words, Ero, E-R-O, cross, C-R-A-S, Ero, cross. They were always putting things together in mnemonic sort of ways so they could easily remember it and recall what was the deep meaning of things. So Ero, cross means I will be tomorrow. And so this leads us right into the feast, the celebration of the Lord's birth. I will be tomorrow. And so we have this wonderful, you know, prayer preparation that concludes the Advent season with this reflection. Every Vespers, Vespers is the hour that concludes the day. And it's on each side of Mary's own words. She praises God for having called her to bear forth the Savior into the flesh. It's heard by one person, that's Elizabeth, who has already rejoiced over her, and John the Baptist in her womb. This older lady has the child leap in her womb, who is already identified as announcing, this is the one. So hope that's a little helpful in understanding these last days of the Advent season.
Father Gutzel, that is a magnificent reflection. Kent Kaholski, our producer, that's when we want to rack up for the archives, most assuredly, and want to again say hello to all of our viewers. A cast will be repeated by demand, actually, on the various YouTube and Facebook sites for Fiat Ministry Network. And again, it's such a beautiful Advent season to have Father Gutzel back with us. It's been terrific. I want to thank Father Gutzel personally for appearing on these broadcasts. And we might just tease out that we might have something further down the line in the future pertaining to Eucharistic miracles. But I want to tell you that on my radio show on Boomer Radio Network out of Omaha, Father's been a regular now with us for several years and always delighted. We try to give him close to the top of the noon hour, so he's got that big audience waiting with bated breath for the Iowa Hawkeye football games, Father Gutzel, even though you're there in Big Red territory.
Yeah, you bet. Well, they're not so big nowadays, but being humbled is the place to start from.
Father, it's delightful to have you again tonight. Could you close out your appearance on the show here with a good Advent blessing for all of us here?
May the Lord bless and keep you. May he let his face shine upon you, grant you his peace and his strength in these Advent days. In Jesus' name, amen.
The great one, Father Michael Gutzel, and we'll have him back soon. Father, stay safe, and best wishes to you as you enter these days of the O-Antiphons and then the Christmas liturgies. It doesn't seem possible that we're getting that close to it, and I know that your parish is still open and that you'll still be celebrating Mass for the Nativity of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Father Gutzel, ladies and gentlemen, the great one, and a tremendous reflection tonight on these O-Antiphons, and much to think of Kent Kaholski, and want to thank all of you that have joined us. We'll close out this evening's program. We always say this program is the intersection of faith and culture and the public square. Father, of course, brought us that beautiful intersection earlier of liturgy and prayer and Bible exegesis. But let's turn tonight, of course, our de facto atheist Marxist media, these events that we're going to show you are often suppressed and not shown, but the president, the commander-in-chief, had a beautiful Christocentric Christmas blessing, and I think we will conclude tonight's show with the President of the United States talking about Jesus Christ, the Redeemer.
Thank you very much. To every family across our nation, the First Lady and I want to wish you all a very, very Merry Christmas. For Christians, this is a joyous time to remember God's greatest gift to the world. More than 2,000 years ago, the angel Gabriel appeared to Mary. He said, "Do not be afraid. You have found favor with God." The angel told her that she would give birth to a baby boy, Jesus, who would be called the Son of the Most High. 9 months later, Christ was born in the town of Bethlehem. The Son of God came into the world in a humble stable. As Christians everywhere know, the birth of our Lord and Savior changed history forever. At Christmas, we give thanks to God and that God sent his only Son to die for us and to offer everlasting peace to all humanity. More than two millennia after the birth of Jesus Christ, his teachings continue to inspire and uplift billions and billions of people all over the globe. His divine word still fills our hearts with hope and faith, and Christians everywhere still strive to live by Jesus' timeless commandment to his disciples, love one another. Above all, during the sacred season, our souls are full of thanks and praise for Almighty God for sending us Christ, his Son, to redeem the world. Tonight, we ask that God will continue to bless this nation, and we pray that he will grant every American family a Christmas season full of joy, hope, and peace. On behalf of Melania and the entire Trump family, Merry Christmas to all, and best wishes for a very, very great and happy New Year. Thank you.
The portico on the lawn, wishing Christmas greetings in the truest sense of the word, focusing on the person of our Redeemer and Savior, Jesus Christ. May God continue to bless the President of the United States and his family. May Our Lady, Protectress of the Americas, the Immaculate Conception, the Patroness of the United States of America, continue to intercede on behalf of our nation. And for all of us here in the Jacobson family household, the lovely and gracious Mrs. Deborah, for Kent Koholski, for all of our friends and family, we wish to each and all of you an early and blessed Christmas season. Jesus Christ is our hope and our life, despite difficult times of pandemic and electoral clouds. We keep our faith, hope, and love always in and for Jesus Christ, our Lord. May God bless you. We'll see you on the other side of Christmas Day, which will still be in the Christmas season. As we all know, there are 12 days of Christmas, and we'll be talking about those 12 days on the other side. Thanks to producer Kent Koholski. This is John Jacobson. God love you.